One of the emphases that I want to make this morning is that we all understand that salvation is a gift. So often we speak about salvation being a gift. And in some ways I think we all have an understanding of what that really means. But in the gists of what God's word is really saying, do we really understand that salvation is a gift? And when we understand that that we are called by God and only by God, that we can see how precious this gift really is and how many have basically battled, had controversies in terms of how they've tried to interpret certain scriptures and how they've tried to see what certain scriptures mean and what salvation is really all about, and many people trying to figure out how does God play the role in terms of Him making salvation real as a gift, and yet we're still working out our salvations in terms of what He has for us. And yet it makes me wonder why so many people play games with salvation that they have. Now, over the last few weeks, we've been speaking about the different spirits that have kept us bound in terms of our flesh, and we're going to continue with that. It's not that it's over, but we will continue with that. And we've looked at how these spirits keep us bound to a system that is really it's not our home. The Bible says the earth is not our home. And therefore the system by which we live is no longer of the earth, but is of God's kingdom, and how God would have us live according to His word and the standards and principles that He's put in place. We've also looked at how these spirits try and keep us bound to our flesh. They try and override God's will, God's plans, and basically God's choices for our lives in general. And so God has a plan. God has basically a will set in place and choices that He so desires for us, but we tend to override them by the spirits that we're allowed to take over. And then the other thing is living in an unrenewed mind. Rather than living with the mind of Christ and God's Spirit ruling in our lives, we tend to be more focused on operating in the flesh because we have chosen to subject ourselves to the flesh rather than growing in the things of the Spirit. And so salvation is a gift. And so many battle with these scriptures, dealing with these issues, dealing with God's sovereignty in terms of salvation. Now, one thing I want to make clear today is that salvation is purely centered on God's sovereignty. It's all about the sovereign hand of God's plan, God's will, God's being, God's power, and outside of it, there is no hope for any human being. And so I want to look at Genesis chapter 25, verse 19 to 34, when we see in that portion of scripture how God speaks to Rebekah. God speaks to Rebekah. We know just before that, how God promises Abraham a seed, and then through Sarah she would give birth to the promised seed. And then later on God speaks to Rebekah in Genesis chapter 25, where He alludes to saying that you will give birth to twins. You'll give birth to twins. And we see in that portion of scripture how God actually chooses, and He says to her before they are born. So it's not based on good works or bad works, on how one thinks or doesn't think. And He already says to her, He says to her that the younger one will rule over the older one. And I have loved Jacob and I have rejected Esau. Now take note, they're not born. They are not born. And God already stipulates a choice and His will over the lives of people. Okay? So nothing we do can basically merit God's favor. It's not based on you. It's not based on what you can do or cannot do for God that gives favor towards you in order to inherit God's love and salvation for your life. The Bible says, after all, by nature, we are children of wrath in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 3. So we, according to God, by nature, are children destined for God's wrath. We're destined for His wrath. Yet He chooses by his will, by his sovereignty, to redeem us, right? Because that's what the scripture says. The Bible also says that in Romans chapter 3, verse 10 to 11, that we as a people group, talking about people on the earth, do not seek God. So, based on nature, we are destined for God's wrath. By nature, we do not seek God in any way. And according to Romans chapter 6, we are slaves to or of sin. Therefore, we are bound. We are purely bound. Okay? We are bound. We are bound. And because of Jesus, and only because of Jesus, as we have sung this morning, we are able to stand before God. Okay? Now, I know you understand that dimension. I know you understand that's what salvation is all about. But I want to go a little bit deeper in terms of what it really means. Okay? So God has made it possible for us to acknowledge Him and to see His qualities. Okay? But because we suppressed the truth in our wickedness, okay? Because we suppressed the truth in our wickedness, according to Romans chapter 1 verse 8, God abandoned us or them to do whatever shameful things their hearts desired. Romans chapter 1 verse 24, 28. So God basically saying in Romans, he declares that God made it possible for mankind to see him through his good works. Okay, that's what it says. God made it possible for man to acknowledge God in God's qualities, in the way with things that God has done, that God made it possible for mankind to see his goodness. But because they chose to suppress his truth in their wickedness, according to Romans chapter 1 verse 18, God abandoned them to do whatever shameful things they so desired. So basically, human nature has been handed over. And we, therefore, by our own lusts, can do things according to that which God has allowed us to do. So I want to look at Romans chapter 9. Let's look at Romans chapter 9. It says, with Christ as my witness, I speak with utter truthfulness. My conscience of the Holy Spirit confirms it. My heart is filled with bitter sorrow and unending grief for my people. This is Paul speaking about the Jewish nation. My Jewish brothers and sisters, I would be willing to be forever cursed, cut off from Christ, if it would save them. Now that's love. I don't know how many of us could honestly say we'd be willing to be cut off from God in order to save a people group. But he says that God be his witness, and by the confirming of the Spirit, what he says is truth. And so we've got to believe basically what he says is what he means. Then in verse 4, he goes on to say, he says, they are a people of Israel, chosen to be God's adopted children. God revealed his glory to them. He made covenants with them and gave them his law. He gave them the privilege of worshiping him and receiving his wonderful promises. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob are the ancestors, and Christ himself was an Israelite as far as human nature is concerned. As he is God, one who rules over everything and is worthy of eternal praise. Amen. Well then, has God failed to fulfill his promise to Israel? No, for not all. Now this is one of the emphases I want to make. For not all who are born into the nation of Israel are truly members of God's people. Now I want you to understand something. I'm going to look at a parallel truth of salvation. Not everyone who is born into salvation, in terms of born again, is truly God's. So he's looking at a nation that he first says belongs to God, is God's, and then he says not everyone born in this nation is actually of God. You're with me. Being descendants of Abraham doesn't make them truly Abraham's children. Okay? Being descendants of Abraham doesn't make them truly Abraham's children. For the scripture says, Isaac is the son through whom the descendants will be counted. Though Abraham had other children too. So basically what he's saying is that Only those that come through the promised seed are those that would be considered God's children that belong to Abraham. Not because they are Abraham's children and they've had other children, do those Jewish people belong to him. In other words, it's a remnant. It's a remnant. This means that Abraham's physical descendants are not necessarily children of God. Only the children of the promise are considered to be Abraham's children. That speaks of salvation. Okay, and obviously those that came out of Isaac's seed. For God had promised, I will return about this time next year and Sarah will have a son. This son was our ancestor Isaac. When he married Rebekah, she gave birth to twins. But before they were born, before they had done anything good or bad, she received a message from God. In brackets, this message shows that God chooses people according to his own purposes. He calls people, but not according to their good works or bad works. Close brackets. She was told, your older son will serve the younger son. In the words of the scripture, I love Jacob, but I rejected Esau. Are we saying then that God was unfair? Is God unfair then? Because he has two children, neither of them are born, yet one is already rejected. So he doesn't even have a chance. He hasn't even come out the womb, but he's rejected. Is God unfair? Is he? Are we saying then that God is unfair? Of course not. For God said to Moses, I will show mercy to anyone I choose. And I will show compassion to anyone I choose. So it's purely up to God. So it is God who decides to show mercy. We can neither choose it nor work for it. You cannot choose salvation in terms of working it out or because you are good or not. It's not based on who you are as an individual. You either can be rejected or you can be accepted. For the scripture says that God told Pharaoh, I have appointed you for the very purpose of displaying my power in you and to spread my fame throughout the earth. That's why he was called. Purely to spread God's fame and to make himself known. So you see, God chooses to show mercy to some and he chooses to harden the hearts of others so they refuse to listen. So why don't some people listen? God hardens their hearts. It's as simple as that. God hardens their hearts so they refuse to listen. Well then, you might say, why does God blame people for not responding? In other words, responding to what he wants them to do faithfully. Haven't they simply done what he makes them do? If I'm rejected and I can't listen and he's hardened my heart, how can you hold me accountable, God? It's what he's saying, right? How can you hold me accountable? Do not say that. Do not say that. Who are you, a mere human being, to argue with God? Don't we tend to argue with God a lot? You're just a human being. Who are you to argue with God? Who knows all things? Should the thing that was created say to the one who created it, why have you made me like this? When a potter makes jars out of clay, doesn't he have the right to use the same lump of clay to make one jar for decoration and another jar to throw garbage into it? In the same way, even though God has the right to show his anger and his power, he is very patient to those on whom his anger falls. So he's destined them to fall, but he shows patience towards them, who are destined for destruction. I didn't say it. He said it. Some people are destined for destruction. Verse 23. He does this to make the riches of his glory shine even brighter, listen to this, on those to whom he shows mercy. So God is shown to be kind and true when he shows mercy to you, for example, Belen, when he's showing destruction to somebody else. That's his mercy. That's, and you'll start praising him for it. Start loving him for it. So God, he makes, so basically says he does this to make his riches of his glory shine even brighter on those to whom he shows mercy, who were prepared in advance for glory. You were prepared in advance for glory. And we are among those whom he selected, both from the Jews and from the Gentiles. So what he's saying is, out of the Jewish nation, some are called, some are rejected. And out of the Gentile nation, some are called and some are rejected. Concerning the Gentiles, God says in his prophecy of Isaiah, those who are not my people, I will now call my people. And I will love those whom I did not love before. And then at that place where they were told, you are not my people, they will be called the children of the living God. Children of the living God. And concerning Israel, Isaiah the prophet cried out, though the people of Israel are as numerous as the sand of the seashore, only a remnant will be saved. For the Lord will carry out his sentence upon the earth quickly and with finality. And Isaiah said the same thing in another place. If the Lord of heaven's armies had not spared a few of our children, we would have been wiped out like Sodom and Gomorrah, like Sodom, and destroyed like Gomorrah. So the point that I want to get to this morning is that salvation is a gift. And the fact is that you are purely destined not to be destroyed. And so the fact that you sit here where you are able to worship and love God is purely a gift. Is purely a gift. And it makes me wonder why so many people play with their salvation. Because it's something you were destined to have. Now there's one thing I want to make emphasis on, because a lot of people get this part confused when they say the Bible says all who call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. So in terms of what we just read, and in terms of what the Bible says, all, how does all fit into some who are destined and some who are destined to be destroyed? You want to know? All does not mean everybody in terms of the whole world. All means terms of those who have been called. So when he says all, that's why it says many have been called, few are chosen. But out of all that have been ultimately called out of God's hand, and are faithful to that call, will be saved. And so when we read it with our human intellect, we want to associate it in terms of it's just everything. But when you put all of the scriptures in comparison and tie them together, and you see how God has separated some over the other, you see all is connected into those who have been called. Being called. Some are destined for destruction. Some are destined for salvation. And all who are called, are faithful to their call, will be saved. That's what says many are called, but only a handful are saved. Only a handful of those are saved. Only a handful of those are saved. So in verse 11 of that same portion of scripture of chapter 9 basically says that salvation has nothing to do with you. Why? Because the Bible says he rejected and accepted from the womb. He rejected and accepted. Does the Bible also not say in the book of John that our names were written in the Lamb's Book of Life before God created the earth. So then was it based on you by birth? Or were you already written there even before he created you? Your name was written, or it wasn't written. It had nothing to do with you. It had nothing to do with you. So salvation has nothing to do with us, but it has everything to do with God's choice, that the Bible says that his choice might stand, that his choice might stand, that his will be done, and so that he calls his family into being. Basically, God is calling his family in. Those that belong to God are his sons, are his family, the Bible says, are his children, are purely as he calls, as he sees fits, as he so desires. Does this portion of scripture not make you see that God is sovereign? Does it? So what does sovereign mean? It means supreme. It means over everything. It means supreme authority to do what he wants and supreme power to act the way he wants. That's what sovereignty means. It means he's independent of all others, not dependent on anyone or anything but himself. He does as he wishes. This is what sovereign means. He can love whom he chooses to love. He can reject whom he chooses to reject. He has the right to be merciful or not, based on his will, not our will. Based on his will and not our will. So again, salvation is a gift. And this is what so many people are missing when they talk about it being a gift. You can now basically live the way you want to live. And that's why you see these messages that bring about hyper grace and false grace messages, when they don't understand that so many people have been given the gift to walk with him. Don't throw it away. Because there are some out there that will never have that ability. Again, the question is God then unjust? Is he unjust then? If some are called, and we read in the scripture, Paul says, how dare we speak? How dare we question? Doesn't God have the right? Does God not have the right? In verse 15, is God therefore unjust? Does he not have the right to show mercy to whom he chooses to show mercy? If Carol decides to make a cake, doesn't she decide to make the cake the way she wants to make the cake? Or does the cake have a right to tell her how to make me? No. Well, I want to be this color, Carol. Or I want to be in that shape, Carol. Or I want this thing on me, Carol. Doesn't have the right. She is the one making the cake. And it's made according to the way she chooses and according to her will and what she sees fit. So it is with God. And people are created the same way. And just because we call God loving, we feel that everybody has the right to be redeemed. Yet there are people out there that are purely being created for destruction, so that God can implement his will, and as I already read to you, so that God's glory may so shine when he shows mercy to other people. That's sovereignty. That is sovereignty. Outside of that, there is no sovereignty. So God can show mercy on whom he chooses to show mercy, and compassion on whom he chooses to show compassion. Notice Paul does not answer with a feeling. Is God unjust? Oh, poor me. Oh, God, unfair. He doesn't move by his feelings. He's not moved by his feelings. He answers with the scripture. Not based on feeling. Predestination, then, of mercy and compassion are according to the kind intentions of his will. Predestination, therefore, of mercy and compassion are according to the kind intentions of his will, because of him who calls. In other words, God has called you. Doesn't the Bible say that? And out of his kind intentions, he now has the right to show mercy and compassion to you because he chooses to. And if he doesn't call you, he doesn't need to. He doesn't need to. It's all up to him. Verse 16 of Romans chapter 9, God does not save us out of our goodness. This is decided before birth, as I already emphasized. Before the foundations of the earth, your name was written in the Lamb's Book of Life, Revelations 13, 18. And in John chapter 10, doesn't Jesus say, let's read John chapter 10. Verse 25, Jesus replied, I have already told you, and you don't believe me. The proof of the work I do in my Father's name. Verse 26, but you don't believe me because you are not my sheep. So some people aren't his sheep. My sheep listen to my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they will never perish. No one can snatch them away from me. No one can snatch them from his hand. For my Father has given them to me. So who gave them to Jesus? God. And he is more powerful than anyone else. No one can snatch them from the Father's hand. The Father and I are one. John chapter 10. Jesus also speaks about a parable in Matthew chapter 13. Right? Chapter 13. Verse 11, you are permitted to understand the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but others are not. Some people have been given to see, some people are not. To those who listen to my teaching, more understanding will be given and they will have the abundance of knowledge. But for those who are not listening, even what little understanding they have will be taken away from them. That is why I use parables. For they look, but don't really see. They hear, but they don't really understand. This fulfills the prophecy of Isaiah saying, when you hear what I say, you will not understand. When you see what I do, you will not comprehend. For the hearts of those people are hardened. And their ears cannot hear, for they have closed the ears, so their ears cannot see and their ears cannot hear. The understanding of these things have been hardened unto them. It's a gift to whom God wants to give it to, according to one who is called according to his purpose. Romans 8, verse 28. All those who are called according to God's purpose. According to God's purpose. Romans 8, 28. Okay. Bible says in Romans 8, 28, it says God knew his people in advance and chose them to become like his son. Verse 29. We just emphasize how Jesus said, God has given me a people and they will not be snatched. Those are the ones he knew in advance. We are to be led by the Spirit for the calling of souls. That's why we always talk about being led by the Holy Spirit. You cannot just go out and save everyone and everyone because not everyone is called. To qualify Paul's statement, he speaks in Exodus chapter 9, verse 16 about Pharaoh, where he says, Pharaoh was raised up for God's name to be proclaimed throughout the whole earth. Verse 18, he has mercy on whom he desires, and he hardens whom he desires, is what it says. He shows mercy on whom he desires, and he hardens, verse 18, on whom he desires. In verse 20 to 21, the potter has the right to make whatever vessel he wants from the same clay. Right? Didn't we say? Whether it's to be beautiful and put on display to give God glory, or whether to be used to be used, whether it be used to throw in garbage and it's for rubbish. It's up to him. But out of the same clay, same mold. Creation is made at his will then. So when we speak about creation, everything is made according to his will, even mankind. All according to his will. Some for honor, some for dishonor. That's what the Bible says. Common use, in other words. Verse 22 therefore speaks that God demonstrates his wrath to make his power known with much patience. Vessels of wrath prepared or predestined for destruction. In verse 23, he did so in order that he might make his riches known of his glory upon vessels of mercy, which he prepared beforehand for glory. So you were prepared beforehand to receive God's glory, that he might get glorified out of it. Ultimately, God looks good. God looks good. Verse 24, even us, whom he also called, not from among the Jews only, but also among the Gentiles. In other words, as I stipulated earlier, it's common, it's both for the Jew and for the Gentile. Called for good and destruction, both Jew and Gentile. Okay. So we are God's vessels, created for his use. That's what the Bible says. So the word vessel in Greek is skuos. Okay, and I don't even know if I pronounced that correctly, but it's S-K-E-U-O-S. It is used in different senses and means utensils, and containers of an ordinary household use. So if I'm eating a particular meal, don't I have the right to use the vessels, the utensils, according to what I want, according to the meal that I'm eating? So in other words, if I'm eating soup, will I use a fork? If I'm going to cut steak, will I use a spoon? He uses vessels as he sees fit. But it also means, and is also used of people, when it is used of people, it speaks of the word vessel, when it's related to people, speaks of individuals. So that same word, vessels, that speaks of people as individuals, is the same name, which means individuals. So in other words, it doesn't mean corporately people are destined for destruction. It means individuals are destined for destruction or glory, not corporate moves. In Acts chapter 9, verse 15, the Bible says, go. He was speaking to the man of God. He says, go, for he is a chosen instrument, the same Greek word, skuos, of mine, to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the sons of Israel. He was speaking about Paul. Remember when people were saying, who's this man? He was a murderer. God says, go and call him. For he is a chosen instrument, purely by God's hand. We are vessels for honor and no longer under condemnation. And so if you have given your life to Jesus Christ, you are then a vessel of honor in terms of God allowing you, because you cannot receive salvation out of his will. In Romans chapter 8, verse 1 to 17, it says, now then there is no condemnation for those who belong to Christ. So obviously if we are in Jesus, there's no condemnation. And because you belong to him, the power of the life-giving spirit has freed you from the power of sin that leads to death. Now that you are a Christian, death, in terms of sin, cannot hold you. Cannot hold you. You are free from it. The law of Moses was unable to save. Okay, so it speaks about the law because of the weakness of our sinful nature. So God did what the law could not do. Okay? He sent his own son in the body like ours, as we sinners have. And in the body, God declared an end to sin's control over us by giving the Son as a sacrifice for our sins. He did this so that the just requirements of the law would be fully satisfied for us who no longer follow our sinful nature, but instead follow the Spirit. Those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things, but those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about that which pleases the Spirit. Now, I want to make emphasis to something. Just because you've been given the gift of salvation, and just because you are born again, doesn't give you the right to live the way you want to live. And that's why he says, those who are subject to the Spirit will listen to the Spirit, not to your flesh. You have been freed from that, and if you are listening to your flesh, you will be a castaway as well. So just as much as you have been given the ability to receive salvation as a free gift, as many have been called, you will not be chosen if you choose to walk in the ways of the flesh. So those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things, but those who are controlled by the Holy Spirit think about things that please the Spirit. So letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death. But letting the Spirit control your mind leads to a life and peace. For the sinful nature is always hostile to God. It never did obey God's laws, and it never will. That's why those who are still under the control of their sinful nature can never please God. But you, listen to this now, he's talking to those who are given their life to Christ. But you are not controlled by your sinful nature. You are controlled by the Spirit if you have the Spirit of God living in you. In brackets, and remember that those who do not have the Spirit of Christ living in them do not belong to him. Close brackets. And Christ lives within you. So even though your body will die because of sin, your spirit gives you life. Because you have been made right with God, the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you, and just as God raised Christ Jesus from the dead, he will give life to your mortal bodies by the same Spirit living within you. Verse 12, therefore, dear brothers and sisters, listen to this, you have no obligation to do what your sinful nature urges you to do. Because you should be subject to what the Spirit wants you to think. Isn't that what we just read? For if you live by its dictates, the flesh, listen to this, you're not, God feels sorry for you, cannot go to hell, says you will die. Speaking to the born again believer. As we just said, he said, but you, dear brothers and sisters, have Christ, he's born again, he was speaking to us. But if through the power of the Spirit you put to death the deeds of your sinful nature, so it's up to us, he says, you will live. So there's a guarantee. If you choose to walk in the faithfulness of how God has called you and are faithful to the calling by salvation over you, where you are no longer bound to the flesh, you are no longer bound to sin, you are free from all of those things cannot control you, you don't have to think after those lusts, you are to be led by the Spirit, you will be saved. You will. You are guaranteed in terms of what God has for you. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are God's children. All who are led. Notice, didn't say all born again, who live in their flesh. All those who follow God, Spirit, are God's children. And this scripture is speaking to the born-again Christian, because we just read, he says, but you are controlled not of the sinful nature. He says, for you are God's. For you are not controlled, for you've been given the Spirit of God. So he's speaking to born-again Christians. And then he concludes that he says that. He says clearly that for all who are not led by the Spirit of God are not God's children. They are not of God. Yet you're born again. Many are called, few are chosen. So in all of that, even though salvation is a free gift, there is a responsibility to work out your salvation with fear and with trembling. In verse 8 or 28 of that same portion of scripture, well, let me carry on reading. So you have not received the Spirit that makes you fearful slaves. Instead, you have received God's Spirit when he adopted you as his own children. Now we call him Abba Father. For the Spirit joins with our spirit to affirm that we are God's children. And since we are his children, we are his heirs. In fact, together with Christ, we are heirs of God's glory. But if we are to share his glory, we must also share his suffering. Verse 28. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love. How can you love God? You cannot love God by nature. As I just said to you, we were destined for wrath. No one desired to seek him. No one desired to do that. So those who love him have been called and are following. By the Spirit are the ones who love him. So if you are called and you're doing what God has called you to do, be led by the Spirit, it means you love him and you are called according to his purpose. Okay? Verse 29, for God already knew them in advance, which I've already shared with you. He knew who those who was his children. Verse 31. So, basically, God does predestination make God's God unloving then, in terms of what we have to say? The answer is no. Why is it no? Because no one can come to God nor understand spiritual things. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 14. So outside of God's love in calling you, no one can come. So the fact that God has called some people is love. If God has called you, it means he loves you. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 verse 14 basically says that no one can come to God and understand spiritual things. In other words, the fact that no one can come to God, if it was left up to mere man, no one would be saved. We would all be walking in our wickedness. We'd all not be seeking God. We'd all be driven by our own lusts. We'd all be looking after our own desires. So the fact that God has chosen to call shows you he's a God of love. He's a God of love. So he calls. So he's called some of us. The Bible goes on to say that we are full of evil, Mark chapter 7, verse 21 to 23. If we are full of evil, means we were never destined to walk in his presence ultimately because of the fall. Is God not then loving when he calls you out of your evil? Of course he is. We as people are lawless in our own, by nature, rebellious, unholy, and profane. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 9. By nature, we are children of wrath, which I already shared with you, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 3. So just purely by the nature of a person, we are not qualified to stand in God's presence. But because of his love, he has the right to call people. That is love. So ultimately, every single human being that's nature is evil was destined, okay, by his choices to remain that way, if it be, or if he chooses to call people out of love, so it be, he chooses to call people out of love. If it were left to mankind, which I shared with you ultimately at the end of the day, man would be destroyed. Romans chapter 2, verse 28. For you are not, listen to this, For you are not a true Jew just because you were born of Jewish parents. So many people turn around and say, look at the Jews, they're born in Israel. You're not a Jew just because you're born of Jewish parents. That's what he says. You are not a Jew just because you're born of Jewish parents. Does not make you a Jew, according to God. I didn't say it. Romans chapter 2 verse 28 says it. Neither are you a Jew because you've gone through the ceremony of circumcision, which a lot of them were trying to proclaim. No, listen to this, a true Jew is one whose heart is right with God. So the question is, who are the Jews? Born again people that are walking right with God. You're a Jew, according to God. You're a Jew. You're a Jew. I'm a Jew. And every born again Jew, Messianic Jew that is saved, is a true Jew. That doesn't mean God's not going to redeem Jews in the end. He is, because they're going to come in by salvation. No, a true Jew is one whose heart is right with God. True circumcision is not merely obeying the letter of the law. Rather, it is a change of heart produced by God's Spirit. In other words, it's salvation. And a person with a changed heart seeks praise from God and not from people. So the moral of the story, basically at the end of the day, is that salvation is a gift. And it's not destined for everyone. And therefore, we are to look after it as a gift and not to abuse it. Amen? Because God has chosen you. And so therefore, if you are seated today in salvation, there is no doubt in your mind, or you should never have any doubt in your mind again, that you are not loved by God because he called you. The fact that he called you means he chose to show mercy. He chooses to show compassion. Why? Because he loves you. And why? Because those who are faithful to walking in the Spirit are those who love him back and were predestined according to the purposes of his will. And that's why he goes on to emphasize that some people were destined for destruction and others were destined to bring about his hand, that others might see the glory and the goodness of who God really is. Amen. It's amazing how this has been a subject of controversy for so long as to what it really means and how all fits in. But all is connected to the call of all who are already in, to remain faithful to him, that we might be chosen at the end of the day. And so, Father, we come before your throne of grace. And Father, I pray that in this word that you would allow each one of us to walk away with any shadow of doubt, knowing that you love us. That you love us, and that you have been destined for us, and called us in the wonderful and the precious name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The emphasis I want to make again is that not all the descendants that came from Abraham were Abraham's children, but only those who came out of the promised seed. In other words, because Abraham had children, not all of those who were Jewish people were called to be his people, but only those that came from the hand of the seed that God had promised. Had they come out of the loins of Isaac, you belong to him. Had you come out of the loins of any other child of Abraham, you are not God's. Okay? It's the speaking of the remnant in salvation. Speaking of the remnant in salvation. Romans 8, verse 3. Can anything separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity or are persecuted or hungry or destitute or in danger or threatened with death. And so one of the points I want to make is so often people allude salvation is all about the blessing of what we get. And so if you are not blessed with these things, then God must be against you. But the Bible says here, does it mean that God stops loving us if we have trouble or calamity, persecution, or whether we are hungry? In other words, he hasn't given you food to eat. Okay? Destitute, you've been left alone, but nowhere to go. Does God not love you anymore? Or in danger, threatened with death? As the scripture says, for your sake we are killed every day. We are being slaughtered like sheep. No, despite all these things, the overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loved us. So one of the emphases that I want to make is that God loves you regardless of where you are in your walk with God. As long as you remain faithful to God, you remain faithful to the obedience of the Spirit, but you find yourself in difficult situations, it does not mean God's not with you. It does not mean that God does not love you. It does not mean God has rejected you. It is all connected to the victories, the overwhelming victories that we have in Christ Jesus, because we need to be persecuted for his name's sake. Amen.